you, Jerry. Thank you to the League of Women Voters for hosting this forum, and thank you to the City of Clawson for making the council chambers available for us this evening. My name is Mike Bosnick, and I am applying for the position of District Court, 5254 District Court, located in Troy, Michigan. I've worked in both Troy and Clawson. I've lived in both Troy and Clawson. I've got 20 years of experience primarily in District Court, much of that in the Troy District Court. And I've been fortunate enough to serve 10 years as a locally elected leader, and I've had the opportunity to represent both Troy and Clawson. As an attorney, I've always felt that one of the best opportunities you have to improve the lives of your fellow community members is as a district court judge. I've seen a lot of district court judges. I'll do what I can as your next judge to take the good traits of those I admire and be the best I can be for our community and continue to try to make Troy District Court an integrated and collaborative part of our community.
Thank you. Ms. DeVito.
I'd also like to thank the Oakland County Bar Association for organizing this forum, as for the League of Women Voters and the Detroit Free Press for also participating in this event. Thank you to the audience for your interest in this election and your attendance this evening. My name is Anne Marie DeVito, and I seek your support for District Court Judge for the communities serving Troy and Clawson. I'm hardworking and highly motivated. In fact, I graduated at the age of 20 with my bachelor's degree. I always knew at a young age that I would attend law school and aspire to be a judge one day. During this campaign, I've made several promises to the voters. One, no political games, no gimmicks. That's not who I am. That's not part of my campaign. I will, however, be open, honest, and diligent. And I've also been back as an attorney for 14 years. You'll find that I possess all the qualities that are necessary to be a court judge, and I seek your support.
Thank you. Ms. McGinnis.
Good evening. My name is Maureen McGinnis, and I'm a candidate for District Court Judge in the 524 District Court serving the communities of Troy and Clawson. I was born and raised in Troy. I graduated Troy High School. I received my Bachelor of Arts degree from the University of Colorado and my Juris Doctorate from Michigan State University Detroit College of Law. I've been an attorney with a small family firm in the city of Troy since we began to practice. During this time, I've handled a wide variety of cases, including everything from family law to criminal defense to certain areas of the probate law. I appear before judges in both district and circuit court on a weekly basis, which has allowed me to gain a wide array of courtroom experience. I'm extremely active in my legal community. I'm proud to say that I'm equally active in the community that I live in with my family. I served on the Troy City Council from 2009 to 2013. During this time, I was selected unanimously by my peers and council to serve as mayor pro tem. I'm honored to be here this evening to have the opportunity to answer questions about my legal career, my legal abilities, and my campaign for District Court Judge. Thank you for having me.
Thank you.
Because we have only 40 or 45 minutes to ask questions in these forums, we ask each of the candidates, the Free Press, the League, and the Bar, to fill out extensive questionnaires whose answers are made available to voters online. Is there a reason you chose not to do that?
Thank you for asking that question. It was not my choice. I was actually out of the state, and I had not received that questionnaire packet until I came back to Michigan. I was at an international event at the University of Tennessee located in Knoxville. And when I had returned from that event, the packet was already due. And so I was looking at it for the first time and realizing that the deadline had already passed. So what I did was put together what I could so that it could be published on the website. And had I known that the questionnaire would be used as a part of a basis for this forum, I would have liked the opportunity to fill it out, but I was not made aware of that.
If arrangements could be made to post your answers after the fact, would you commit to filling it out in turn?
Okay. Absolutely.
Thank you. I have a different question, obviously, for Ms. McGinnis. Ms. McGinnis, you describe yourself, I think, as a family law specialist, which is not an area of the law that the district court gets into much. You have a relative lack of experience in civil and criminal law. How has your particular career prepared you for the demands of district court?
Thank you for letting me answer that question. largest and most significant number of cases that I have that are ongoing are family law cases. Those are civil cases. So I'm operating under the same rules of procedure, rules of evidence that I would be utilizing if I were a judge in the district court. So in terms of my courtroom experience, I think it would be equal to anyone that's practicing primarily in district court. I meet four judges on a weekly basis. I have to be familiar with the same rules that everyone else does in order to present their case or to hear a case if I were to be sitting on the bench. So I think I have the same, if not more, training in terms of my courtroom experience. I have the ability to handle many district court matters as well, civil cases, misdemeanor cases, judging here at the district court, as well as civil infractions. So I'm in district court quite a bit, and I feel very comfortable being able to provide some different cases.
Thank you. And Mr. Bosnick, you've run for partisan office 5 times before. You've been active in Republican Party politics for many years. Now you're running for a nonpartisan judicial office. Do you think that judicial elections should be partisan? And if not, why doesn't your extensive record as a partisan politician put you at a disadvantage in a nonpartisan race?
Well, I guess just the best way for me to answer that is I am who I am. I know in some judicial races it's sort of quasi-partisan. We have the parties nominating the nominees for the Supreme Court and the Court of Appeals, and then they go on a nonpartisan ballot. There are many elected positions that are nonpartisan that enable us to serve the community aside from judicial positions. I was able to serve over 9 years on the Clawson School Board as a nonpartisan position, was able to serve my community in that capacity. Township Board, City Council, those are all nonpartisan. I think it's at the lower levels, particularly like something like District Court, School Board, City Council, nonpartisan I think is preferable because people, when people hear the partisan identification, they come with a predisposed notion of who you are or where you come from. Okay, there are going to be people that don't vote for me just because I currently sit on the county board with an R next to my name. There are going to be people that vote for me because of that. But being on a nonpartisan ballot, I just ask to be judged by my life experience, by my professional experience, and by my service to the community.
Stated that the information that we have on you is very, very limited. So my question to you is, exactly what do you do by way of practice? It indicated on your public information sheet that you're a practicing attorney, but it doesn't say in what capacity. I mentioned something about being of counsel, and then it said that you contract your services out. So my question to you is exactly what do you do?
I'm in court, and I attend hearings 3 to 5 times a week. I work for a law firm. And I practice on many different areas of law, family law, civil cases is most of the practice that I do. I also do landlord-tenant cases, which is also a district court subject matter for district courts. So I am in the district courts and the circuit courts on a very regular basis, and I attend many court hearings in district courts.
So you're a partner as well?
I'm of counsel, yes.
Your partner,
yes.
Or your of counsel?
I'm of counsel. I do not. I work for actually a couple different attorneys at a couple different law firms. So I work for 2 different law firms, mm-hmm. and I service those attorneys. And my basic role is to attend court hearings for them.
Thank you, Ms. McGinnis. In your questionnaire, you indicated there was a question regarding if a litigant came in front of you and had incompetent counsel. And you had indicated that you would not in front of the litigant, but perhaps take them in chambers and discuss that with the counsel. Do you think that is your role to advise an attorney who may be, in your opinion, ineffective?
I think it is my role to make sure that every party that comes before me or every person that comes before me has an equal opportunity at having justice served. And if I saw that I was that they had either selected or was trying to represent them was in some sense having people in doing this, and it appeared that they were not going to have that equal opportunity for justice. I don't think it's my role to counsel all attorneys to make sure that they're doing their job up to my standard, but I think if there was some sort of glaring observation that the person that was appearing before me on whatever matter was not going to have a fair and equal opportunity of having justice served, attorney refused to remove himself from the case?
I mean, at that point, then it would most likely be something for an appellate court to decide if that became the case. But if there was something that I could do to intervene before it was at a standstill at that point, I would like to be able to do that.
Mr. Bosnick, on your questionnaire, you indicated that as far as the local bar association, it had lasted for over 10 years. Do you think that that's necessary, that a judge who would be part of the legal community, do you think it's necessary that he or she would be part of the local bar association, which does things with young lawyers, they do things with the public, they sponsor events such as this? Do you think that's something important, or is it just something that you don't think?
Well, not, it's just something that I've, you know, with the time that I have, I've decided to invest that time in being involved with other organizations, other things like the Optimist Club. I was on the school board for 9 years. I've got involved in youth sports and things like that. I think there are a very number of ways that an attorney can serve the community and a judge can serve the community other than being in the local Oakland County Bar Association.
So you're saying you don't think the judge
should not be a requirement.
Well, it's not a requirement, but I'm just saying for you personally what you think.
It's something that that I was in for a period of time, and I decided to spend my time pursuing other things that were more beneficial, I saw, to my community and more beneficial to my family. The Oakland County Bar Association does a great job. It sponsors a number of charitable endeavors, like you said. I think you know, they're very involved with young lawyers and bringing them in. I was a member of the Oakland County Bar Association for a few years, and then I've done other things since then.
Thank you.
Next question was, one is, why are you seeking to become a district judge? And the second part is, why should we vote for you?
Can I do more than a minute? Why am I seeking and why should you vote for me? This is a position that, for a very long time, has been something that I aspire to and have the opportunity to run for. I think that the role of a district court judge is twofold, and both of those things are very important to me. The district court judge is obviously someone that is responsible for keeping the community safe, but they're also someone that has an impact on property values and many things that are important to the residents of the local community. But I also see that person, the district court judge, having the ability to be a leader in the community, a local leader, and someone that can give back in ways, many ways, not only on the bench, but in the endeavors that they choose to associate them with off the bench. Both of those things are extremely appealing to me. I think that I have a proven track record in terms of my service to the community and in terms of my service to the legal community. Both of those things have been absolute high priorities to me since the beginning of my practice, since the very first day that I started practicing. So I think for both of those reasons, people should see me as a very suitable, not the best choice for this position, and those are the reasons that I'm seeking this position.
Thank you. Mr. Bosnick.
Why? I think, as I indicated previously in my opening, I think as being an attorney, one of the best opportunities you have to improve the lives of others in your community is as a district court judge. I've been involved in a number of specialty district court programs, such as Drug Treatment Court in Troy, Veterans Court in Medford, sobriety courts in a couple of different district court jurisdiction, and I've seen the way a district court judge can impact the lives of individuals, helping folks break addiction, putting families together, keeping communities safe. And, you know, I live in Clawson, okay? Clawson's a community. I walk here today. I enjoy the notion of community. I like to promote the notion of community. District courts are community courts. They're the incubators for various programs such as Team Court, Court in Schools, and a number of things that have had positive impacts upon our communities. So if there were a circuit court opening, I would not be interested. District court, I think, is where you have the most opportunity to make the biggest positive change in the lives of folks, that your neighbors and your friends.
Thank you. Mr. Vito.
I too only seek to serve as judge at the district court level. I don't have an interest in the other judicial opportunities. I think that when the community is ever going to have an experience in a courtroom, it's going to be at the district court level, not in a circuit court, not in a federal court. I think it's important for that district court then to welcome those individuals, make them feel comfortable, make them feel like that as a judge sitting on the bench, whether you have counsel or not, whether you've been in a courtroom or not, that you're going to listen to their information and evaluate what has been before you and be impartial, making the decision. Why vote for me is the American Bar Association does, as Mr. Henry stated, has many standards, 8 standards that are considered when they appoint federal judges, and that those standards are also adopted by the Open County Bar Association. There's 8 of them. I feel that I possess all 8 of those qualities that are necessary for a judge, just to have a personality or be able to listen to people. That's just one quality. You have to have several, I think, in order to be a well-respected judge. And I believe I do. I have all of those qualities.
Thank you, Judge, unless you really like to. Could you tell us what the worst thing you've ever seen a judge do in a courtroom is and how you would have handled the same situation differently?
Unfortunately, as well-respected as the judicial position is, there are judges on occasion that exhibit behavior that I would not consider exemplary or that kind of behavior that should be committed from the bench. There's nothing more embarrassing than walking into a courtroom, whether you're an attorney or a party, and doing your best, being prepared, thinking you know what's going to happen, and the judge embarrasses you in one way or another, whether even if you're right, sometimes that still happens. And it makes me wiggle in my seat when I see it happen. It's happened to me, and I've seen it happen to other attorneys and those without counsel. And I would ensure that I would never do that. And I would always behave in a manner that does not embarrass anybody.
Ms. McGinnis, same question. Worst thing you've ever seen a judge do in a courtroom and how you would handle it?
You see it from time to time, and I think it gets back to that notion of consistency. You're looking to have someone that has that commitment, and there have been occasions when you're in a courtroom, and you probably can't pinpoint exactly why you're seeing the behavior. It could have many reasons, but it's a situation where a judge is responding in a way that's absolutely unexpected, and it doesn't seem warranted. And it not only catches the attorneys off guard, I would say that probably the 3 of us up here have seen it happen enough that you get accustomed to it and maybe don't take it as personally. But for someone that's coming into the courtroom for the first time, a citizen, a business owner, and has that type of experience, I think it can be scarring for them. So I think that you really have to be able to leave your personal issues outside of the courtroom and remember that whatever is going on around you, even if it's behavior in the courtroom that you don't find appropriate, there's a way to handle that, and that is not and falling off the handle, that's not having an irrational response. You need to have that level of consistency so that people know what to expect when they're coming into the courtroom.
Mr. President, same question.
I think the jurists that have a strict policy for any particular matter and are unwilling to consider the fact of the situation as something that I will not, I take a dim view of as an attorney. To have like a no adjournment policy or to treat a particular case the same way no matter what the facts are. I think when you have judges that it might be easy to say you're going to have a uniform policy for a particular type of case for a sentence or a particular type of policy with regards to trying a matter. But I think once judges start doing that, it's easier, but you're abdicating your responsibility to take the facts of each case, each individual case, and apply the law. And taken all those.
There's a district judge in another district who's famous for
correct.
Sentencing to jail every first offense driving under the influence.
Correct.
You're opposed to that.
I would look at if the facts of the case warranted jail, then that person would go to jail. But I would not have a hard and fast policy because I think you're advocating a responsibility to deliberate the facts of each particular situation. I think people elect judges and they expect them to deliberate on their case, not just do a cookie-cutter approach.
Thank you. Why does a judge who is there to enforce the law as it exists now, why is it useful to know that that judge favors changing the law, and why doesn't that shake confidence in the judge's impartiality?
Well, I think you may be referring to, there's different types of questionnaire rights life has. There's a legislative questionnaire and a judicial questionnaire. I'm pro-life, I'm conservative, I make no bones about that. I think when you assess a judicial candidate, you look at their entire body of work, you look at their entire life experience, look at their entire work experience. If I were endorsed by a local police organization, why wouldn't somebody say, well, that person always is going to be for the police, and they're not going to stick up for, or they're not going to listen to defendants? I think to take sort of such a broad brush and for one endorsement is, I don't think it necessarily is in the interests of giving a fair assessment of the judicial candidate, but in that vein, I am pro-life.
Thank you. Ms. DeVito, slightly different question. You said in your opening statement that you've known since you were very young that you wanted to go to law school and to eventually become a judge. Besides going to law school and practicing law ever since, what have you specifically done to prepare to be a judge?
I think being in the courtroom on average three or four times a week, I think that experience alone has prepared me in being a judge and serving on the bench. With that experience, I am in many different district and circuit courts in the Tri-County area, so I'm before many different judges. And I think that preparation alone is something that you cannot learn in law school, or you cannot learn by sitting in an office. I think it's a unique experience, and I do have that experience.
Let's see if I could follow up just for a moment. It sounds to me like the experience every trial lawyer has. My question was, when you decided that you wanted to be a judge, even before you went to law school, what did you do to prepare to be a judge as opposed to preparing to be a good trial lawyer, a good legal citizen?
I would often just go in the courtroom and sit there, and I would observe what the judge does. And I've done that on numerous occasions. I've done it before I entered law school, while law school, and obviously as an attorney.
Thank you. Ms. McGinnis, you've spent a good deal of time on the Clawson City Council. Troy City Council, forgive me. what achievement as a city council member can you point to that you think recommends you particularly for a judicial office?
I think my answer is going to be a little bit of a big picture answer, because during the time that I was on the city council, there were so many things that I pointed individually that I think that we tackled as a group, as a council meeting body, and that I officially, in my own capacity as an individual on the council, spent time, hard work, energy, or spent years trying to make a decision that I thought would be in the best interest of the citizens. I think the body of work that occurred during that 4 years that I was on council goes to show that there's an importance in being able to work together as a group for the common good to make a difference. And I think that the situation that we found ourselves in 2009 and the decisions that we made as a body that propelled us forward and really made a positive impact on the community as a whole, those are things that together, all of those decisions together, I'm very proud of, and I think this is a lot about my character.
You have the opportunity on some criminal cases to appoint attorneys. How would you go about appointing attorneys to represent litigants who are unrepresented in criminal cases? What would you require that attorney to
give to a defendant?
Well, it would absolutely not be a requirement that particular individual contributed to my campaign in order to get a referral from my courtroom. There are many ways in which which courts appoint attorneys.
Or what would you do?
What would I do?
Yes.
Oh, well, I participated in a program while in law school at 33 District Court, and I was actually acted as public defender. There's a court rule that allows law students to do so. And that experience, I thought, was wonderful. Judge LaRose is the chief judge over there in that district court that also allowed us that opportunity. I think that would be a great opportunity for law students. As far as other attorneys being appointed, I think well-respected attorneys in your community. Usually judges have some sort of a reference list that where they can refer attorneys, litigants to attorneys.
So is that what you would do?
I would utilize both, yes.
Ms. McGinnis. If you were elected as judge, there are situations where you have criminal misdemeanor cases that you would sentence an individual. And upon sentencing, there are some times when defendants violate their probation. You've got a defendant who's come before you on a violation of probation, and the allegation is that he or she failed to pay fines and costs. Your probation officer, who did the sentencing recommendation on the violation, recommends jail. What would you do?
Well, although you provided some specific facts, in my opinion, if I was sitting up here and presiding over the matter as a judge, I don't know if that would necessarily be enough facts for me. Across the board.
Well, I'll give you more facts. They've done everything they're supposed to do, except for pay, fines and costs.
I would inquire as to why the fines and costs have not been paid. Obviously, I think
because they don't have money.
Because they don't have money. I think that someone that's appearing before the court, they do have the ability to pay their fines and costs in other ways, such as community service. And if it was a simple issue of someone that had successfully completed all of the terms of my probation, and was otherwise someone that could be considered to be released from probation, but for the fact that they did not have the money to pay the fines and costs, if there was another alternative, and I would seek to inquire as to whether or not they would be able to do community service in our community in lieu of fines and costs.
So you'd go against what your probation officer would recommend that they jail him?
In the limited facts scenario that you're giving me, it sounds like that would be something that I would absolutely consider doing. If there could be other factors involved that may support what is being requested by the probation department, but I think that there would be an opportunity in a case such as what you're describing to see if they would be eligible for completing community service in my community rather than go to jail because they can't finish paying the fines and costs.
Thank you. Mr. Bosman, you've already mentioned that you are pro-life and that is your right to be pro-life. This is a situation, you are sitting as the elected judge, and a pro-choice individual comes before you, having violated a city ordinance for a parade demonstration or something of that nature. Would you recuse yourself from that case?
No, I would handle that case as I would any other case. I don't think my judicial demeanor, my judicial temperament wouldn't make any difference to me whatever they're the local persuasion was, whatever their leaning was on a particular issue. You take a look at the Pearson in front of you, take a look at the facts.
Particular
like you're saying, would I outlaw pro-choice demonstrations or something?
No, of course not. You couldn't if it wasn't the law. What I'm asking is, if they come before you, having broken the law, and it was a pro-choice demonstration, would you recuse yourself?
No. I would treat them as I would any other litigant or any other defendant that comes before me. I wouldn't treat anybody any differently because they have a particular view on a particular topic. I take a look at the nature of their actions, determine take in the interest of safety of the community, and make a determination based on that. That the whole pro-life, pro-choice thing would not enter into my thinking at all. So I wouldn't recuse myself.
Thank you.